آیہ نمبر 196. وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ وَأَتِمُّ. أَتِمُّ is from the root letters تَامِيمِيم, from the word تَمَام, إِتْمَام, to complete something, to perform something fully in such a way that nothing at all is left out. So أَتِمُّ, it's a command. You should complete. You should completely perform. You should fully carry out. What? الحج, the Hajj, والعمرة, and the Umrah, for who? لله, for Allah. وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ, complete the Hajj and the Umrah for the sake of Allah. What is الحج and what is العمرة? Hajj and Umrah, they are, you can say, the pilgrimage that a person performs. He goes where? To the Kaaba, to the house of Allah, and he performs a pilgrimage over there. Hajj is the major, the greater pilgrimage, and Umrah is the minor, the lesser pilgrimage. Hajj is from Hajim Jim. Hajja is to intend. So Hajj is to intend to go to the house of Allah at a particular time to perform certain rituals. So Hajj, it cannot be performed any time of the year, but it has to be performed at a specific time of the year. And in Hajj, you don't just go visit the Kaaba, pray salah and come back. No, there are certain rituals that you have to perform. And Umrah. What is Umrah? It is from Ayn Mimra. We have done the word Ya'muru, right? So it means to populate a place. Okay? To populate a place. So Umrah is, you can say, a visit to the house of Allah. The constant visits to the house of Allah by people throughout the year, which keeps the haram, which keeps the house of Allah populated and busy. There's no place on this earth that is as busy as Baytullah. Any other place. It could be a mall, it could be a theme park, could be anything. What happens to it? It eventually shuts down for at least a day, or a part of a day, or a week, or a month, or a season. Right? Even for renovations. But the house of Allah, no matter what is happening, even if it's being cleaned, or the kiswa, the cover of the Kaaba, is being changed, or there are renovations going on, is it ever shut down? Never. Why? Because there are people coming for Umrah. They're constantly populating the place. So Allah says that أَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةِ, complete the Hajj and Umrah لِلَّهِ, for Allah. Meaning when you go to perform Hajj, then complete it. And when you go to perform Umrah, then complete it. Don't do like this, that you're on your way and you perform one ritual and you're like, I'm too tired, man. Forget it. Next time, I'm going home. No. Once you make the intention to perform the Hajj, to perform the Umrah, then you have to complete it. You know, professionals, one of their qualities is that they finish what they start. They don't have 20 projects that are still going on, and they're like, yeah, I'm supposed to do it, but I can't do it. No. Whatever they start, they finish it, they complete it. So for example, if you are a professional person, and you started this course, then what will you do? Inshallah, you will complete it. And if you don't complete it, what does that mean? You have a casual attitude. You're not serious. Not a professional. So anyway, Allah says, وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ. Allah says, لِلَّهِ. What does that mean? That when a person performs Hajj or he performs Umrah, then he must do it for whose sake? For the sake of Allah. It is the right of Allah that these rituals be performed for His sake exclusively. In Surah Ali Imran, Ayah 97, we learn, وَلِلَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ حِجُّ الْبَيْتِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ إِلَيْهِ سَبِيلًا. Due to Allah from the people is a pilgrimage to the house for whoever is able to find their way. Meaning whoever is able to take the journey, he must perform the Hajj for whose sake? For whose sake? For the sake of Allah. Because if a person performs even the biggest good deed, but not for the sake of Allah, then it's not accepted. So وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجِّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ. So there are two things that we learn from this. First of all, that complete Hajj and Umrah. And secondly, do it for whose sake? For the sake of Allah. Even when it came to fasting, we learned وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةَ, complete the number of fasts. Don't leave them incomplete. Don't leave them unfinished. Likewise, Hajj and Umrah, once you set out, you have to complete. And you see, these are acts of worship. And anything that you care about, what do? You complete it, you finish it. And if you don't finish it, what does it mean? You don't really care about it. So for example, if you have, you know, an essay that you're supposed to write, and you write half of it, but you don't complete it, can you submit it? No, you can't. Can you get any marks for it? Not at all. Can you be graded for it? No, you can't. And if you don't complete it, you don't submit it, what does it mean? You don't care about it. Because if you cared about it, then you would definitely complete it. If you don't complete something, it means that you've lost interest in it. But Hajj and Umrah are rituals. And just the fact that they are acts of worship, they deserve respect. And what does it mean? That once we start, we should complete. And by extension, any good thing we begin, what should we do? We should complete it. But let's say a person sets out to perform Hajj, to perform Umrah, but a situation happens. And what is that? فَإِن. So if. This is the first scenario. أُحْصِرْتُمْ. You were restricted. حَصَدْرَ. حَصْر. حَصْر is to surround something. Okay? And إِحْصَار is to surround something, to encircle something, so that it is restrained within. It cannot come out. Okay? It cannot come out. So, أُحْصِرْتُمْ. You were restrained. Meaning, you were prevented from continuing the journey. So for example, a person gets their Hajj visa. They leave from their country. They're on their way. They get to, let's say, Jeddah. And when they're there, they say, no, there's a problem with your visa. We can't let you in. You have to go back. And you're like, no, this is valid, this is this. And they're like, no, because of whatever reason, and you don't understand what they're saying, and they can't understand what you're saying. So they say, you can't come, and they put cancelled stamp on your passport, and you're supposed to be going home on the next flight. أُحْصِرْتُمْ. You were prevented. Whatever the reason was, you're not able to go, you're not able to continue. Similarly, it's possible that a person is on his way and he falls extremely ill. Let's say 2 days into Hajj, he's at Mina, for example. Okay? He's at Mina and he's so sick, he is so ill that he cannot continue. He's prevented by illness. Alright? Or for example, something happened back home. A person is going for Hajj. He gets there early, a week in advance, and before even the day of Hajj begins, he gets a call. Your mother is extremely ill. Get back right now. So he has to go. He left with the intention of Hajj, but he can't complete it. So it could be different situations. So فَإِنْ أُحْصِرْتُمْ. Then what should a person do? Then he will obviously discontinue his Hajj or his Umrah, because his circumstances don't allow him to continue. But can he just come out of the state of Ihram? Because remember that in Hajj and Umrah, a person is in the state of Ihram, right? And you can't come out of the state of Ihram until you have performed all of the rituals. Okay? Inshallah, we'll go into the details later, but just something small to make you understand that you can't just come out of the state of Ihram like that. You can only come out after you have completed all of your rituals. The rituals include, for example, slaughtering the animal, likewise cutting off the hair, doing the rami, so on and so forth. So, but if a person has not done that, so what is he going to do? Can he just come out? Yes, he will, but he has to do something else in return to make up for what he did. And what is that? He has to slaughter an animal. So Allah says, فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ. فَمَا, so whatever. اسْتَيْسَرَ, it was easily available. يَا سِين رَا. يُسْر. What does yusr mean? Ease. So اسْتَيْسَرَ, it was easily available. It was feasible. You can obtain with ease. مِنَ الْهَدِي, of the sacrificial animal. Meaning then you have to offer whatever sacrificial animal is easily available to you. Meaning whatever you can afford. Al-Hadi is from the root letters Hadaliya, and Hadi is the animal that is offered as sacrifice. By the way, people sometimes feel that, why do you have to sacrifice animals, you know, as a part of worship? It's not a big deal. I mean, you eat meat all the time. Don't we eat meat all the time? People slaughter animals all the time. So, you slaughter an animal as a ritual as well. There's nothing gross about that. Okay? The blood, you don't do anything with that. You have to discard it. Okay? The blood does not become holy. No, the meat does not become holy. It's just that the animal has to be slaughtered to show that you can spend anything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's symbolic. So anyway, فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. Hadi is the animal that is offered as a sacrifice, the sacrificial animal. But why is it called hadi? It's called hadi because remember the meaning of the word huda? Hidayah? What does that mean? Guidance. And it means to go from one point to the other. From one point to your destination. So hadi is the animal that is taken from outside of the haram into the haram. People would bring it with themselves. And it would be sent to the haram, to its mahil. And then it would be slaughtered over there. So likewise, hidayah is what? Transformation. That a person was at point A and now he is different. You know, sometimes people want to know, am I rightly guided? Then you have to check yourself. Are you different from how you were before? How's your salah? How's your heart? How's your thinking? How's your dhikr? How's your habits? That will reflect whether you have transformed or not. So anyway, فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. So this is the expiation for not completing the Hajj or Umrah. What is the expiation that a person has to offer? A sacrifice, right? Sacrificial animal. And which animal does it have to be? Which animal does it have to be? An elephant? No, you can't slaughter elephants for Hajj. A camel? A goat? A sheep? What should it be? Whatever a person can afford. Whatever he is able to do. فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. One more thing that you have to do to come out of the state of ihram is that you have to shave, you have to cut your hair. For the men, shave the hair or trim it. And for the women, trim a little. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that وَلَا تَحْلِقُوا. And do not do halq. Ha, lam, qaf. Halq is to shave, right? To completely remove. And qasr is to shorten. And over here does not mean that you have to shave, but meaning don't cut your hair, don't do that yet. رُؤُوسَكُمْ. رُؤُوس is a plural of رَأْس. So don't shave off your heads, meaning don't shave the hair of your head, or don't trim it, حَتَّى until يَبْلُغَ it reaches. Ba, lam, ghain. Until it reaches al-hadiyu, the sacrificial animal, where mahillahu, its place of slaughter, its destination. So a person has to offer an animal, it has to be sacrificed, but only after the animal is sacrificed, then he will shave the hair or trim the hair, and after that, a person is out of the state of ihram. He is officially not doing Hajj anymore. And there's no sin on him. There's no blame on him. What is mahil? Mahil is from the root letters ha, lam, lam, and halal is halal. Okay? Permissible. So, mahil is the place where an animal is going to be made halal. Meaning it's going to be slaughtered. It's that place. What is that place? That place, it is the haram. Okay, it is the haram. That's where the hadi is sent. But let's say a person is not able to get the sacrificial animal all the way to the haram. Then what should they do? What should they do? Think about it. I'll tell you an incident. The Prophet ﷺ and the companions, they set out in the 6th year of Hijrah in order to perform Umrah. And at this time still the Mushrikeen and Muslims were at war. Okay. Now imagine, the Prophet ﷺ, the Muslims are going to Makkah to perform Umrah. And the Mushrikeen, when they found out, they're like, no way, we cannot let them enter at all. So they stopped the Muslims from entering. And after much back and forth, it was decided that the Muslims don't come this year for Umrah, but rather they come the following year. And that is when the Treaty of Hudaybiyah was signed. Now the Muslims were in their ihram. And they had their sacrificial animals. You think that the mushrikeen would let their animals come into the haram? If they didn't let Muslims come in, would you think they would let their animals come in? Never. So, what should they have done? What did they do? Sacrifice wherever a person can. Okay? So, mahil. Ideally, what is it? The haram. But if that's not possible, then wherever a person is. So, once the animal is slaughtered, then a person can trim the hair, and then he's officially out of the state of ihram, officially his Hajj Umrah is discontinued. Another situation, a person started off for Hajj Umrah, but فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ, then whoever was among you, مَرِيضًا ill, مِيم رَضَاد, he was extremely sick, extremely ill. أو or بِهِ with him, meaning he had أَذَن, أَذَن, an injury, some harm, some ailment, مِنْ رَأْسِهِ, in his head. أَذَن is from the root letters Hamza Dalia, and Adha is any kind of ailment, any kind of pain, harm, suffering that a person experiences, that is basically experienced by a living being. So for example, if you cut a piece of wood, you don't say that you're hurting the wood. Likewise, if you're cutting, if you're chopping a carrot, it doesn't mean that the carrot is screaming. Okay? But if you cut up an animal, then yes, he will suffer, he will feel the pain. Likewise, if you a human being, again, he will suffer the pain. Okay? So, adha, the person has some adha, where min ra'sihi, in his head. Let's say the person had a severe head injury. He was in his Hajj or doing his Umrah and he fell and he hurt his head really bad, and the doctors have to, let's say, stitch up the head or have to do some kind of procedure, and that requires that the hair has to be shaved off. You understand? This is another situation. A person is doing Hajj, he became extremely ill, or his hair has to be cut. His hair has to be trimmed. Now in that case, can he do that? He's at Hajj, he's at Umrah. Can he do that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَفِدْيَةٌ, then some fidya. Then yes, our religion is very practical. If a person is at the verge of dying, he's bleeding, then you can't say, no, he's at Hajj, so you can't cut the hair. No, you will cut the hair. You have to do that. But the person has to do something else for the violation that was done. And what is it that he has to do? فَفِدْيَةٌ, then he has to give a fidya. Fidya, فَادَلْيَا, ransom. What is that ransom? مِنْ صِيَامٍ, of fasting, أو صدقة, or charity, أو نسك, or sacrifice. So he has three options of fidya. He can either fast, how many fasts? From hadith we learn, 3 days. أو صدقة, or he can give صدقة. How much صدقة? That he has to feed 6 needy people. أو نسك, or a sacrifice, a slaughter. نسك, نون, سين, كاف, مناسك, right? أرينا مناسكنا. Nusuk is sacrifice. So that person has the option to choose from these three. He can either fast for 3 days, he can either feed 6 needy people, or he can slaughter an animal. And which animal? That has to be either a sheep or a goat. Meaning a smaller animal, not a big one. Not a camel or a cow, but rather a smaller one. So this is the second situation, which is that a person was doing Hajj, everything was fine, but he became extremely ill. He cannot continue the Hajj anymore. Okay? Or the hair has to be trimmed. So what's going to happen? He should cut the hair, he will come out of Ihram, he will cancel his Hajj, his Umrah, but he has to give the fidya in order to make up for what was done. The first case was uhsirtum, a person cannot continue for Hajj at all. Okay? But this case, the second one, is specific to illness. Okay? This is specific to illness, and also such a situation in which the hair has to be cut. Okay? In which the hair has to be cut. So, in that situation, this is what a person will do. فَإِذَا أَمِنْتُمْ, normal circumstances. فَإِذَا, so when, أَمِنْتُمْ, you all are secure. Hamza, Mim, Noon, Aman. Everything is fine, there's security, there's peace everywhere, there's nothing to prevent you, there is nothing to cause any trouble, you can easily go for Hajj, you can complete it, you can complete your Umrah. Then, فَمَن تَمَتَّعَ, then whoever was تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ. تَمَتَّعَ is from مِيم تَاعَيْن, مَتَاعَ, benefit. And تَمَتُّعَ is to gain benefit, to take benefit. Okay, to take advantage. So, whoever was taking advantage of doing what? بِالْعُمْرَةِ, of doing Umrah, إِلَى الْحَجْ, to Hajj. Meaning, he was taking the advantage of performing Umrah with that Hajj as well. Inshallah, we'll tell you the details later, in the next lesson. But just a little bit, there's three types of Hajj. Okay? It doesn't mean that the rituals will be different, but the requirements are different. Three types of Hajj. Does anyone know? Does anyone know what they are? Okay? One is Hajj Tamattu'. Hajj Tamattu' is performed by outsiders, meaning people who don't live in the area of Haram, but they live outside. And what they can do is that they can perform Umrah when they arrive, and they will come out of the state of Ihram. And then when the days of Hajj come, then they will put on the Ihram again, and they will perform the Hajj. So basically, one trip, one journey, two Ihram, and two rituals. Okay? One trip. You travel from Canada once to Saudi and you go for, let's say, 15 days. You get there, for example, 3 days before Hajj. So you get there with your Ihram, you do Umrah. After your Umrah, after one day, you're out of the state of Ihram. For 2 days, you're free, you're happy, you're praying in the Haram, everything's normal, you can get a haircut, you can cut your nails easily. But when the time for Hajj comes, then what will you do? You will put on the Ihram again. So you took advantage of performing Umrah on one trip. You understand? So this is Hajj Tamattu'. Another type of Hajj is Hajj Qiran. Qiran is from Qarn, to join. And that is that a person joins Umrah and Hajj in one Ihram. One Ihram, but Umrah and Hajj. The third type is Hajj Ifrad. And what is that? Only Hajj. One Ihram, but only one Hajj. No Umrah. Okay? No Umrah. So these are the three types of Hajj. Over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning, which one? Hajj Tamattu'. That whoever is taking advantage of performing Umrah until the time of Hajj, meaning until he enters the Ihram of Hajj, then, فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ, then, فَمَا, then whatever, إِسْتَيْسَرَ, it was easily available, مِنَ الْهَدِي, of the sacrificial animal. What does this mean? This means that the one who is performing Hajj Tamattu', he has to also offer a sacrificial animal. This does not mean that the sacrificial animal is some kind of fidya. No. This is an obligation that is imposed on him. Because he is taking advantage of doing Umrah and Hajj. Right? So he has to be more grateful to Allah. And this is why he has to offer a sacrificial animal. Okay? So, فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. He has to offer a sacrificial animal. This is a requirement from him. Because he is performing this kind of Hajj. And what's the reason behind that? What's the reason that I told you? What's the reason? Why does he have to offer the animal and others don't? Because he has the opportunity to do more, to gain more. So when he's doing more, he has to be more grateful. So this teaches a very important lesson in life, that whenever Allah gives us the ability to do extra that other people are not able to for whatever reason, then what does it mean? We have to be even more grateful. فَمَسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. But let's say a person made the intention of Hajj Tamattu', he does Umrah and he's doing Hajj, but let's say when it comes time to buy an animal to slaughter it, he cannot afford. He cannot afford it. He made the intention already, but when it comes to actually slaughtering the animal, he realizes he doesn't have that much money anymore. Something happened, perhaps he lost his wallet. It happens at Hajj, right? He lost his wallet and there is no way that he can get money from home before the time of Hajj ends. So what should he do then? Should he go on begging people, asking them for money? No. Allah says, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ. So whoever does not find. Wow, jim dal. Meaning whoever cannot afford. Then what should he do? فَصِيَامُ. Then fasting. He has to fast. How many fasts? ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامُ. 3 days. أَيَّام, plural of يَوْم. Then he has to fast for 3 days. فِي الْحَجِّ. In Hajj. Meaning in the months of Hajj. Okay? He has to make those fasts in that season of Hajj. Not that next year he thinks, okay, yeah, I'm supposed to make up those 3 fasts, so I'll make them up now. No. In that given time. Fil Hajj. He should fast 3 days during the days of Hajj, during the months of Hajj. And this can be done that he can fast 3 days before Hajj. Okay? If he knows that he won't have that much money. Or he can fast after the 13th. Okay? So he can fast 3 days either before Hajj or he can fast 3 days after Hajj. Because for the Hajjaj, they don't fast on the day of Arafah. Okay? They're not allowed to do that. Nor can he fast on the day of slaughter, Yawm al-Nahr. So there are certain rules. So 3 fasts in the days of Hajj, وَسَبْعَ, and 7 fasts, إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ, when you return, meaning when you go back home. So in total, how many fasts? In total, how many? 10. 3 over there and 7 on going back home. Tilka, that is 10, 10 kamilah, complete. Meaning, it has to be 10 complete fasts. A person cannot fast only 9 or 8 or 7. No, it has to be 10. Thalika, this rule is for who? Liman, for the one who, lam yakun, he is not, ahluhu, his family, hadiri. Hadiri. Hadiri is actually hadirina. Okay? Hadirina. But the noon has been dropped because hadirina is being connected with al-masjid al-haram. And hadirin is the plural of hadir, from the root letters hadara. What does hadara mean? Id hadara ya'qub al-maut. Hadara. To be present. Right? So hadir is one who is present. And it means a resident of a place. Someone who lives in a particular place. He's a resident of a place. So this rule of what? Hajj tamattu'. And if a person cannot find the sacrificial animal, then fasting. A total of 10 fasts. This rule is for who? For the one whose family does not live, is not a resident of al-Masjid al-Haram. Meaning Hajj tamattu' will be performed by who? Those who don't live in the area of Haram. Those who don't live in Makkah. Those who live in Makkah, they will do other Hajj. They will not do Hajj tamattu'. Hajj tamattu' is for who? Those who live outside of Makkah. Because think about it. How can you make up 7 fasts when you go back home? If your home is the haram, you can't do that. Right? وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, and fear Allah. وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ, and know that indeed Allah is severe in retribution. عِقَاب is from the root letters عَيْن قَافْ بَا. And عِقَاب is punishment. And it's from عَقِب. عَقِب is heel. So it follows. Meaning when a person does something wrong, the punishment follows. It doesn't leave him. It comes against him. So وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Why is this said over here? That these are the rules of Hajj that you have to strictly observe. If you're not able to do one thing, then you have to make up from the other way that Allah has told you about. You cannot take these matters lightly. This is not something that is very small, very insignificant. No, this is something that's very major. Because we learned earlier that وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةِ, for who? For who? لِلَّهِ. And when it's the right of Allah, then it has to be performed properly with the fear of Allah. And a person must never take this matter lightly, because you are doing Hajj for Allah. And if you don't do it properly, He knows. And if you fall short in your duty, then He will punish. It's a very long ayah, but you can see that there are many things that are mentioned in it. I'll quickly read through it, so all that we studied can come together, can be consolidated in your minds. Because it's a little technical, so it's important that we understand this properly. So if you just look at the Arabic, I'm only going to read the Arabic. Okay, I'm not going to go into the translation. وَأَتِمُّ الْحَجَّ وَالْعُمْرَةَ لِلَّهِ. Complete the Hajj and Umrah for who? For Allah. But if a person is not able to, فَإِنْ أُحْصِرْتُمْ, then what should he do? فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. Offer sacrifice, whatever is available. But فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. وَلَا تَحْلِقُ رُؤُوسَكُمْ حَتَّى يَبْلُغَ الْهَدِيُ مَحِلَّ. Another thing that you have to do is shave your head, trim your hair. But you cannot do that until the animal is actually slaughtered. Another scenario. A person is sick, and because of that sickness, the hair has to be cut, or he cannot continue. فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا أَوْ بِهِ أَذًى مِنْ رَأْسِهِ, then what should he do? فَفِدْيَةٌ مِنْ صِيَامٍ أَوْ صَدَقَةٍ أَوْ نُسُكٍ. He should come out of the state of ihram, he is going to discontinue his hajj, and then he has the choice. He can choose from one of these three options. What are they? Siyam, aw sadaqa, aw nusuk. Another situation. فَإِذَا أَمِنْتُمْ. Normal circumstances, there is no problems, nothing is preventing a person from continuing his hajj, but he is doing hajj tamattu'. فَمَنْ تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ إِلَى الْحَجِّ, then it is his obligation that he has to, فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. He has to offer a sacrificial animal. But if he cannot afford, فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ, then فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ, then he has to fast 3 days, فِي الْحَجِّ, in the days of Hajj, وَسَبْعَ, and 7 fasts, إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ, on going back home. But this rule is for who? Is for who? تِلْكَ عَشْرَةٌ كَامِلَةٌ, 10 fasts, but this rule is for who? ذَلِكَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ أَهْلُهُ حَاضُرِ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ. This is for the one who is not a resident of the haram, but rather he lives outside. And Allah warns us, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَاعْلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Fear Allah and know that Allah is severe in retribution. In other words, take the matters of Hajj very, very seriously. Is anybody going for Hajj this year? Does anyone know? Inshallah. Does anyone know of anyone who's going for Hajj? Right? So, before going for Hajj, a person must educate himself about what he is going into. Because many times it happens that people are there and they're just asking each other, so what are we supposed to do next? What are we supposed to do next? And in just trying to figure out what they're supposed to do, they lose the spirit of Hajj completely. They cannot focus on ibadah. So all of these rules, Allah has told us why. So that we can focus on ibadah. Okay. Inshallah, we'll conclude over here. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.